Now, in 2005, I competed in and finished the Lake Placid Ironman. Now, if you don't know anything about the Ironman, it's three events where you swim 2.4 miles, then you bike 112 miles, and then you run a marathon 26.2 miles. It was a daunting task, to say the least, but I'll also say that I don't feel I'm a real athletic guy. I think I was just really stubborn. I wanted to do it. I set my mind to do it. And it's because, quite frankly, I said, a marathon, I could do a marathon, but Ironman is impossible. And anytime my mind hears that, oh, it's impossible, I kind of go for it, right? Now, here's the thing about training, folks. Listen, when it comes to running, I found I could always grind it out. If I had to run a long way and I was tired or my joints were sore, I just grind it out. Just keep running, right? Just push through it, John. And same thing with cycling. If I was on the bike and I was getting chafed and my muscles were sore, my back sore, I could just kind of grind it out. Not so with swimming. Didn't happen with swimming. See, swimming was very different. I wasn't a great swimmer. And swimming, the Ironman was different than normal swimming because you really want to use a lot of upper body. You want to preserve your legs because you still got a bike and a run to do. So it was a lot of upper body, a lot of torquing, how you torque your body, and how you balance. You see, because if you swim like this, you're dragging your hips through the water and it's a lot of resistance. You want to swim like very parallel with the water, kind of like you're sitting on a surfboard. So every paddle propels you forward but doesn't keep you afloat. Okay? So in training for the swim, I had to learn to swim to really good form. And the mantra kind of was you swim to form, meaning that you keep swimming until your form gets bad. And when the form gets bad, you get out of the water, meaning that you had to train for the swim different than the bike and the run. Once your form got bad, you're done because all you're then doing is practicing struggling. Now, when it comes to studying for the PA boards, when it comes to studying for your pants, you gotta study like you swim, meaning that you only have to study to the point of good form, highly effective studies. Guys, I'd rather people study 2 hours a day that was really, really effective than 8 hours a day. I cannot tell you how many people who come to me and say, "Okay, John, I got boards in 5 weeks. I'm gonna study for 8 hours a day for 5 weeks." And I'm like, "No, you're not. You can't. You can't, not highly effectively." People mistaken time for effectiveness. Okay, I get that question all the time. "Hey, how long after your board review course should I take the boards?" And I'm like, that's a faulty paradigm. Any faculty member, any board review instructor who gives you an honest answer to that, they got a broken paradigm. Because it's not about time, it's about knowledge. Do you understand that? It's not about how long it takes, it's about how much do you know the stuff. So when it comes to studying for the boards, you have to deeply know it, and especially in light of the 2019 pants changes where the passing rate has gone up and more people are going to fail. So you have to know this like the back of your hand. You can't just kind of wing it. You have to deeply know it. So it's not about time, and you have to study to the point of highly effectiveness. And again, if you only gave you 2 hours a day that was highly effective, that's better than 8 hours a day of highly ineffective time. Guys, you know this, like going to the gym, right? You can go to the gym for 8 hours a day, but if you're not really working out, you're kind of lifting very light weights, you're not going to get stronger. I'd rather you give me two good 25-minute sessions. That's way better than 8 hours in the gym. So study effectively. So what does that mean, John? How should I study effectively? Well, here's the techniques that I recommend. First and foremost, have a highly disciplined study plan. And that means get away from distractions. Now, if you study in a group, that can be highly effective. I feel like groups can make you study for longer periods of time as long as you're not chit-chatty, right? So I think groups can be very effective. I'm going to assume you don't have a group, okay? So get away from all distractions. Entrepreneurial studies show that 2.6 hours of interrupted study time equals 1 hour of uninterrupted study time. So get to a point where you're uninterrupted. And here's the deal, guys, eliminate distractions. It takes about 15, 20 minutes to get your brain perfusion pressure optimal for you to learn. So that means get away from places and turn off your phone. Don't answer texts. Don't talk to people during your studies because it'll disrupt your thinking. So number one, get away from distractions and set a discipline plan. I can study for about 50, 60 minutes before my brain becomes a little bit poor in form. So guess what? I study for about 45 minutes and I take a break. So I want to keep my brain optimized. Study smartly, and that's the Questions of Mastery. If you have not heard about them, go to questionsofmastery.com. here's the deal. I've taught lots of people Board of View courses, and I need you to think about content differently. The questions of mastery, the tool is that every single disease that's going to be on the boards, you have to answer four questions about them. Number one is, what's the pathophysiology? Number two is, how's the patient going to present? Number three is, how do I diagnose it? And I'd like you to think in terms of three buckets. What's their physical exam findings? What's their lab findings? And what other images to include EKGs? What are they going to show you to make the diagnosis? And number four is, how do I fix it? How do I apply therapeutics to it? Okay? So think about them. And if you go to questionsofmastery.com, we have a study guide that you can download for free so you can start checking off your own boxes so you can know what you know. Okay? So you want to study to form. Last thing is this. And I don't know how I can teach people to really apply this individually, but I can as groups. If you're a faculty member or if you work at a PA school or a student in a school, you have to change your paradigm. And what does that mean? You're taking test questions as students. I need you to become test writers. I would like every student to become a test writer, a high-end test writer, because if you learn to write test questions for the pants, you're going to become better at answering questions, okay? That's the deal. That is the deal. So I would challenge every program director and faculty member out there to turn your students into test writers. It's going to make them think different. It's going to have them help them give them an advantage. You see, one of the things I do at my Board of View courses is I talk about anticholinergic side effects, right? And I use it in terms of atropine. And I say that there's a linking technique. You have a bat wearing a hat, okay, holding a bone, hitting a beat over a fire pit, hitting a beat over heat. So the anticholinergic side effects, and I use this linking technique because I have a bunch of learning tools, right? Bat, hat, bone, beat, and heat. And I write that on the board. I say, okay, listen, I'm going to call on someone in the audience. You're going to help me write a test question. I say, 22-year-old female overdoses on an unknown substance. And I have them think it's a tricyclic. Patient presents with blank. And then I have them fill in what comes next. And the students will always say, well, they have dilated pupils, altered mental status, dry mucous membranes. Okay, beautiful. That's fine. And that's a good student answer. But test writers aren't going to write that way. They're going to describe it. So they're not going to say dilated pupils. They're going to say pupils are fixed and minimally reactive at 8 millimeters. They're not going to say altered mental status, not responding to examiner's questions, thrashing about. So they're not going to tell you dilated pupils. They're going to describe them. Now, if you start writing test questions, you'll see that yourself. Okay? So, my hope is that this information helps you to look at content different and look at how you're studying for the boards different. Okay, I'm deeply, deeply invested in this process. Okay, the NCCP has raised their standards on passing the boards, which means anybody who's preparing for the pants, you better change how you study, you better change how you study, or you're going to be one of the casualties of this change. I know a major PA program, a legacy PA program, who last time reported their pants pass rate, it was 97%. This year, it's going to be down to 75%. So this is very real. It's very real. So if you're a student studying for the boards, study to form. Study to form. Don't study for time. Study to form. Study to deep-seated knowledge. If I can help you at all, okay? And when I say help you at all, I'm really talking to the strugglers out there, okay? The people who are really struggling, please contact me. We'll have a phone call. I'll talk to you about what you need to do at no charge, okay? This is my calling. My calling is to help people get through the boards. And please listen, if anybody out there is a student and who needs to pass their boards but they're deeply struggling, please contact me, okay? People say, John, I'm really struggling and I need help. Guys, we have Board of View courses. Come to our Board of View courses. We have videos. We have all sorts of study material that can help you that I've optimized and maximized over the years. And here's the deal, guys. If you can't afford it, I don't care. We'll get it to you anyways, okay? I need to pass the boards because you're going to affect about 5,000 lives per year, and this is my calling. Okay, so if you can't afford it, that's fine. Pay me once you graduate and you're making money, okay? We'll put you on a deferred payment. I don't care about that. You need to know this, okay? This stuff, it's a really big deal. It's a catastrophic deal. I get it. I get it. And I've altered my teaching strategy for this new environment. It's a really cool thing what the NCCP has done, raising standards. It's scary, but here's the deal. Taking a CPA exam is very difficult. Everybody knows that taking the CPA exam is very difficult. So when you pass it, it's worth that much more to you. Well, the NCCPA turned up the heat. That's beautiful. So we have to adapt, overcome, and that means new strategies. And at CME for Life, that's what we do. Every board review course out there, you need to ask them, how have you adopted and adjusted your strategy to this new system, to the new grading score? That's the question. Anybody who does board review courses, you got to ask, how have you adjusted? How are you going to teach different? Good luck and God bless.